Providing documentation for our software is important not only for our clients, but also for our future selves. And that's no different for our web APIs. In this video, I want to dive a little bit deeper into the OpenAPI spec and show you how we can customize that Swagger UI experience to provide more detailed information about our project. Before we start customizing our Swagger UI, let's take another look at it to see what we get out of the box. At the top, you can see I have the name of my project, but right underneath it, I also have a link here that links to that OpenAPI doc that tells me details about my operations. If I head back to the center, I can see all of the available API endpoints for my project. So here are my error endpoints and then the ones associated with my recipes controller. When I took a look at these, I don't see a lot of information about what these exactly do. If I click on them, I can see the parameters and I can also see the responses at the bottom. When we look at the responses, notice it only shows me the successful responses. I have no idea what happens whenever exceptions or errors are thrown inside of my app. Let's take a look at the post operation. We can see an example of what the shape of the request body should look like whenever it hits our API. But again, as I scroll down and I look at responses, I don't see the correct responses. This doesn't return a 200 level status code, it returns a 201. And then I also don't see any error status codes being shown. Let's head over to Visual Studio and start customizing some of these things. Inside of my startup.cs file, I'm going to head down to the configure services method. And what I want to do is add some general information about my API. So I'm going to select this code block and I'm going to paste in some of my own information. Here you can see I've updated the title and I've also added a description, contact information, and also information about the license. In this case, I'm using an MIT license. I just need to make sure that I include all the using statements that I need for this. Now, when I save this, I should see the changes inside of the Swagger UI since I'm using .NET Watch. And here you go. You can see that it's added some of that general information here. You can use this to add whatever general descriptions you need for your API. Let's see how we can add some more details to these operations. Back in Visual Studio, let's head over to our recipes controller. And for our get operation, I want to add a description using some comments. Returns a recipe for a given ID. All right, we'll save that. And when I tab over to Visual Studio and I refresh this page, it's not showing anything. I must be missing some more information. Let's take a look at the project properties. I'll go to project and I'll hit on properties. Now to make sure that those comments actually generate documentation, I need to hit this checkbox to enable the generation of an XML documentation file. What I'll also do is I'll remove the absolute path and just make this a relative path. Now, if any of you have ever turned this on before, you know that that could generate a lot of warnings sometimes. So I'm going to let Visual Studio know that it should suppress those documentation warnings. Let's save that and let's head back to that startup.cs file. We need to let Swagger know that it could use that documentation file for our API descriptions. Let's include these using statements for these missing types. And here in this code I've just pasted, I'm just grabbing that generated document and passing it along to Swagger. All right, let's save this and see what happens now when we head back over to the Swagger UI. So if I refresh this page, notice how my description is now getting included in my operation. But we still have the wrong status code, so let's see if we can fix that. So back in Visual Studio, I'm going to go to my recipes controller. And there are two attributes that I want to add to my controller. That's produces and consumes. And these attributes let the Swagger tools know that we're producing and consuming JSON inside of our API. Now going down to our get operation, we can use some more attributes that'll specify the status codes that this operation returns. So you can see I'm using the produces response type, and I'm saying it returns a 200 okay, and also a 404 not found. Let's save this and head back over to the Swagger UI. When I refresh this page, let's click this operation. And there you have it. Now I have my 200 success and also my 404. Notice the media type that's here only says application.json. And that's because of those attributes that we added to our controller. And now you've seen how you can start customizing that Swagger UI by adding some attributes to the controller. Why don't you start going through some of the other operations in the API and add some attributes of your own? In the next video, we're going to see how we can take some of this documentation that we're generating with Swagger and use it to generate web API clients.